don't understand the suffering of the cross, how will you ever have the power? As Moses lifted up the serpent, so shall the man, Son of Man, be lifted up. And those that believe in him, lifted up on the cross, shall not die but have everlasting life. For God so loved the world. And darkness came over all the earth. So I stretched out my hands all day long to a fault-finding and disobedient people. He said, but they will be exterminated if they do not listen. So they rejected him. So God says, I have rejected them. So now all nations can be blessed. Jehovah Tsidkenu, the Lord is our banner. You know, so I've revealed myself only to Moses as all the redemptive names. So if I look at a prophet like unto Moses, what is he trying to tell us? I stretch out my hands all day long by standing on a hill till the sun went down. And if you can realize that, you will say, his banner over us is love. Thank you for the cross.
And now for today's life-changing message entitled, The Cross, Our Banner.
Right, Deuteronomy 18, verse 15. The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet. This is Moses speaking. The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet from the midst of your brethren like me. I mean, he didn't say Moses was like Jesus. It says Jesus was like Moses. That's an awesome prophecy for a man to stand up and say, God will raise up a prophet and he will be like me. I mean, that's an awesome prophecy, you know. He says, and to him ye shall listen. This is what you desired of the Lord your God at Horeb. So Moses says, he's referring to that mountain, how they complained and how they argued with the Lord. And he said, you must remember when you were at Horeb and you were arguing with God. Now, I want to say to you, God will raise up a prophet. God will raise up a prophet. And Moses says, he will be like me. And for interesting sake, that's why they stoned Stephen. You know, because, I mean, they were legalistics and they said, Moses, Moses. And he said, no, you know, it's actually Jesus. And they stoned him for that. So let's read on. He says, let me not hear again. That's what they said. We don't want to hear the voice of the Lord again, lest we die. And the Lord said to me, they have well said all that they have spoken. I will raise up for them a prophet from among their brethren like you, and will put my words in his mouth. Now, God is speaking after Moses prophesied. Yeah. So God is confirming the word that Moses prophesied. And he shall speak to them all that I command him. And whoever will not hearken to my words, which he shall speak in my name, I myself will require it of him. So God says, this is the one that you will listen to. He will be like Moses. Acts chapter 3, verse 18 will do, I think. He says, thus as God fulfilled what he foretold by the mouth of all the prophets, that his Christ should undergo ill treatment and be afflicted and suffer. Now, when Peter wanted to wrap the story up of how this lame man got healed at the gate called Beautiful that was sitting there for 38 years, he said, if I want to tell you how this thing happened, it was all the prophets prophesied that Christ must come and suffer. Not one prophet, all the prophets. So if you don't see the crucified Christ in the prophets, you haven't read the prophets. It says, all the prophets prophesied about the suffering of Christ. It says that he would suffer. So repent, turn around, return to God, that your sins may be erased, that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord. And that he may send you the Christ, who before was designated and appointed for you, even Jesus, whom heaven must receive until the time for the complete restoration of all that God had spoken by the mouth of all his holy prophets for ages past, from the most ancient time in the memory of man. So I just want to say, Jesus is not coming when things are going bad. Jesus isn't coming for a worn-out, backslidden church. Jesus is coming when everything is restored and supposed to be like it's supposed to be. And the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 15, when the kingdom, when everything is subdued to man. It says, so the Father said to Jesus, sit on my right hand till I make thine enemies thy footstool. So when everything is subjected to Jesus Christ or to the church, then Jesus Christ will come for his kingdom. And then he will take the kingdom, give it back to the Father. That's the restoration of all things. So Jesus will not come before the kingdom is totally established on this earth. Verse 22, here it comes. Thus Moses said to the forefathers, the Lord God will raise up for you a prophet from among your brethren as he raised up me. Him shall you listen to and understand by hearing and heed in all things whatsoever he tells you. And it shall be that every soul that does not listen to and understand by hearing and heed that prophet shall be utterly exterminated from among the people. Indeed, all the prophets from Samuel and those who came afterwards, as many as have spoken, also promised and foretold and proclaimed these days. So Peter says, if you are questioning what's happening now, all the prophets told about this. So why is it that you don't understand what's happening? So you didn't read the prophets. So if they understood the prophets, they would have known Jesus was to be crucified. If you don't understand the suffering of the cross, how will you ever have the power? Verse 25, you are the descendants of the prophets and the heirs of the covenant or the testament which God made and gave to our forefathers, saying to Abraham, and in your seed shall all the families of the earth be blessed and benefited. It was to you first that God sent his servant and son Jesus when he raised him up to bless you. Now, that raising up was not from the dead. That is a prophet like unto Moses. Just for interesting sake, that's not raised from the dead, because he didn't come to Israel after he was raised. He came to Israel born as a baby. He says, and God said by the mouth of his prophets, all nations blessed. How? Because of the seed. Now, who is the seed? Galatians 3 says, he promised unto Abraham and his seed, not unto many seeds, unto seeds as unto many, but as seed as unto one, and that is Christ. But if you belong to Christ, then are ye Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. So it's not an ethnical group. It's not a cultural group. It's not a colored group. It's not a national group. It's all nations, all tribes, all tongues, all from every tribe and tongue and nation will stand before the throne of God. So if we don't understand this, and that's why Jesus Christ died. Amen. He was raised up from among his brethren and he appeared to the Jews. He said, I'm sent to the house of Israel. I'm sent to the house of Israel. I'm sent to the house of Israel. And he said, but this generation. And he actually cursed his generation. He says, this generation does not accept me. So what will happen? He said, I will turn to the Gentiles. Now let's go to a prophet like me. Will God raise up from? So let's go to Moses. Exodus chapter 17. All the congregation of the Israelites moved on from the wilderness of Sin by stages according to the commandment of the Lord and encamped at Rephidim where there was no water for the people to drink. Therefore the people contended with Moses and said, give us water that we may drink. And Moses said to them, why do you find fault with me? He says, why do you tempt the Lord? So Moses says, if you're finding fault with me, you are tempting God, because God raised me up. Yes. Now listen, but the people thirsted. Therefore, water, and the people murmured against Moses and said, why did you bring us up out of Egypt to kill us and our children and livestock with thirst? So Moses cried to the Lord, what shall I do with this people? They are almost ready to stone me. They want to kill me. Kill me. And the Lord said to Moses, pass on before the people and take with you some of the elders and take in your hand the rod with which you smote the river and go. Behold, I will stand before you there on the rock at Horeb. Now, keep your finger there and quickly go to 1 Corinthians chapter 10. He says, for I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, that our forefathers were all under and protected by the cloud in which God's presence went before them. And every one of them passed safely through the Red Sea. Remember when he took up his rod and things like that? And each one of them allowed himself also to be baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea. an obligation to the law, to Moses, and to the covenant consecrated and set apart to the service of God. And all of them ate the same spiritual, supernaturally given food. And they all drank the same spiritual, supernaturally given drink, for they drank from a spiritual rock, which allowed them, produced by the sole power of God Himself, without natural instrumentality, and the rock was Christ. Nevertheless, God was not pleased with a great majority of them, for they were overthrown and strewn down along the ground in the wilderness. Now listen, if they don't listen to the prophet that will be like Moses, they will be exterminated. But what about them that didn't even listen to Moses? They were also all exterminated. Okay? Now he says, these people came to a rock and they all drank the same water, but the rock was Christ. Yes. And the water was supernatural. Yeah. So let's go back to Exodus 17. Verse 5. And the Lord said to Moses, pass on before the people. Verse 6. Behold, I will stand before you there on the rock at Mount Horeb. Now, Horeb was called the mountain of God. So God said to Moses, Moses, take some of the elders and go to the rock. But don't look for a rock. See me. And I will stand there before you on the rock. What did God say to Moses when he wanted to see the glory in Exodus 33? Moses, I will stand before you there on the rock. And I will hide you in the cleft of the rock. And my glory shall pass before you. And the Lord came and called his name before him. Great is the Lord, merciful, gracious. You know, remember the story. So I will stand before you there on the rock. So he said, Moses, if you come there, but hit the rock. The rock shall be smitten. Who is the rock? The Lord is our rock and our fortress. The Lord is my rock. Psalm after psalm, he's my rock. He's my rock. He's my rock. He's my rock. And what do we do with the rock? We hide in the rock. We go to the rock. And what happened to the rock? The rock is cleft for me. He says, and you shall strike the rock, and water shall come out of it, that the people may drink. Okay? And we just read it. And what did Jesus say in John 7, 37, 38, 39? Remember? When he stood on the last day of the feast, if anyone thirst, let him now come to me. And as the scripture said, if you believe and come and drink, from who? From me. Rivers of living water will flow from your belly. So what did he say? I am the rock. And I'm going to be cleft. And if you believe that and come to me, you shall never thirst and you shall drink and water shall come out of you. Instead of you drinking, you shall pour out water. Okay? So Jesus is prophesying. And he called the place Massa and Meribah because of the fault finding. Remember that word, fault finding. Then came Amalek and fought with Israel at Rephidim. And Moses said to Joshua, choose out men and go out. Fight with Amalek. Tomorrow I will stand on the top of the hill with a rod of God in my hand. So Joshua did as Moses said and fought with Amalek, and Moses, Aaron, and Hur went up to the hilltop. When Moses held up his hand, Israel prevailed, and when he lowered his hand, Amalek prevailed. But Moses' hands were heavy and grew weary. So the other men took a stone and put it under him, and he sat on it. Then Aaron and Hur held up his hands, one on one side and one on the other side. So his hands were steady until the going down of the sun. And Joshua moved down and disabled Amalek and his people with a sword. And the Lord said to Moses, write this for a memorial in the book, and rehearse it in the ears of Joshua, that I will utterly blot out the remembrance of Amalek from under the heavens. Verse 15, and Moses built an altar and called the name of it, the Lord is my banner. Okay. He stood on top of a hill, stretched out his hands till the sun went down. Now remember Jesus on the cross when the sun went down and all that. And then he built an altar and he said, all this, the Lord is my banner. Let's go to Psalm 60. Oh God, you have rejected us and cast us off. This is more or less what he promised, wasn't that? That he's going to cast away the nation that doesn't listen to the prophet. You have broken down and scattered us. You have been angry. Restore us and turn yourself to us again. Now you've got to read the whole book of Jeremiah to understand that. You have made the land to quake and tremble. Ooh, the whole Isaiah and Jeremiah comes out here. You have rent it. Repair its breaches, for it shakes and totters. You have made your people suffer hard things. You have given us to drink wine that makes us reel and be dazed. But now you have set up a banner for those who fear and worshiply rever you, to which they may flee from the bow, a standard displayed because of the truth. Selah, pause and think about it. That your beloved ones may be delivered, save with your right hand and answer us. Okay? He said, God raised up a banner. Now I'm just picking up. To save us. To redeem us. To deliver us. And we can run to it. Isaiah 13. Lift ye up a banner upon the high mountain. Exalt the voice unto them. Shake the hand that they may go into the gates of the nobles. I have commanded my sanctified ones. I have also called my mighty ones for mine anger, even them that rejoice in my highness. The noise of a multitude in the mountains, like as of a great people, a tumultuous noise of the kingdoms of nations gathered together. The Lord of hosts mustereth the host of the battle. They come from a far country, from the end of heaven, even the Lord and the weapons of his indignation to destroy the whole land. Howl ye, for the day of the Lord is at hand. It shall come as a destruction from the Almighty. Therefore shall all hands be faint, and every man's heart shall melt, and they shall be afraid. Pangs of sorrow shall take hold of them. They shall be in pain as a woman that travaileth. Now listen quickly. When Jesus went to the cross in John chapter 16, he said to the disciples, you shall be like a woman that's in travail. You shall have much sorrow. But your sorrow shall be turned into joy, and I will send you another comforter, even the Holy Spirit. So he says, first of all, tonight I'm going to be crucified. When I go to the cross, it's going to be a lifting up of a banner on a high hill. You will have sorrow like a woman in travail. But your sorrow will be turned into joy, and I will send you another comforter. So let's look at the rest. They shall be in pains as a woman that travaileth. They shall be amazed one at another, for their faces shall be as flames. Acts 2, verse 1 through 4. When the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. All of a sudden there was a sound like a mighty wind, and they were seen cloven tongues of fire that sat upon each of them, and they were all amazed. Yes. Okay? Behold, the day of the Lord comes. Cruel both with wrath and fierce anger to lay the land desolate, and he shall destroy the sinners thereof out of it. I just want you to see something. And we can read scripture upon scripture that God will raise up a prophet like Moses, and we've got to listen to him. But all the prophets prophesied about the suffering of Christ. And if we understand the suffering of Christ in all the prophets, we will realize that all nations can now be blessed. To understand that, Moses says, I'm going to stand on the top of a hill and I'm going to stretch out my hands till the sun goes down. And this will be the banner. And the Lord will raise up a banner. And if we understand this banner, we will be saved, redeemed, and delivered. So what is the banner? His banner over us is love. What is the banner? It's not Jesus. It's the crucified Christ. Without the cross, there's no banner. The banner is on a high hill with outstretched hands. Let's go to Song of Solomon, chapter 2. I am the rose of Sharon and the lily of the valleys. Do you believe it or don't you believe it? As the lily among the thorns, so is my love among the daughters. As the apple tree among the trees of the wood, so is my beloved among the sons. I sat down under his shadow with great delight, and his fruit was sweet to my taste. He brought me to his banqueting house, and his banner over me was love. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave. But verse 14 says, as Moses lifted up the serpent, we just read it. As Moses lifted up the serpent, so shall the man, Son of Man be lifted up. And those that believe in him, lifted up on the cross, shall not die but have everlasting life. For God so loved the world. John 15:13, greater love has no one that he lays down his life for his friends. So the love of God is showed when he laid down his life. So if his banner over us is love, that's where God portrays his love. Greater love has no one that someone lay down his life. For God so loved that he lifted up his son like a serpent on a pole. And if they look on him, and now we've heard that the cross is the opening of the door to go into the banqueting house. Right? And it's a co-thing. Revelation 3:20. If you open your door, I will come in and sup with you. Banqueting house. John 14:24. And the Father and I will come, and we will make our house with you. We will come and stay with you. Yeah. Romans chapter 10. Verse 21. But of Israel he says, all day long I have stretched out my hands to a people unyielding and disobedient and self-willed, to fault-finding, contrary and contradicting people. I think it's enough. Jesus says, what did Moses say? Why are you busy with fault finding? Remember? We read it twice tonight. You find fault with me, you're tempting God. Why are you busy with fault finding? So he says, all day long, I have stretched out my hands. And when my hands got tired, the people of God started losing the battle. So they had to stretch out his hands till the sun went down. Okay, Father, in thy hands do I commit my spirit. And darkness came over all the earth. So I stretched out my hands all day long to a fault-finding and disobedient people. He said, but they will be exterminated if they do not listen. So they rejected him. So God says, I have rejected them. So now all nations can be blessed. How? But by looking to the crucified Christ. And if we can see him suffering, that's what all the prophets prophesied. So the whole story of the gospel of Jesus Christ is he died on the cross. And if we can understand it, we will understand what Moses did. How did he lead them out? Go to Deuteronomy chapter 4, chapter 5, chapter 7, chapter 8, chapter 11, chapter 9. You can go right through the whole book of Deuteronomy. I think just about 3 or 4 chapters that doesn't say it. Every chapter in the book of Deuteronomy, I have led them with an outstretched arm.
Yes.
Led them with my hand and with outstretched arm. I led them with my hand with outstretched arm. So he's trying to say, all the time I'm trying to say to them, I'm their redeemer. I'm their deliverer. I'm their savior. How did they go out of Egypt? By slaying a lamb and put the blood on the lintels and the doorposts. What did they have to do? They had to eat and they had to drink. They had to eat the unleavened bread and they had to drink the cup and they had to keep the Passover. All the times, God says the Passover you must keep throughout eternity. That's the only feast that he says you must keep. And when Jesus died, he said, this bread is my body broken for you. And when you eat it, proclaim my death till I come. This cup is my blood in the New Testament. Drink it and proclaim my death till I come. So now I can look at everything that Moses said. You know? I am the Lord that healeth thee. What did he do to Moses? He said, I revealed myself to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. But I never revealed them as I did to Moses. As Jehovah. Jehovah Rapha, the Lord that healeth thee. Jehovah Roi, our shepherd. Jehovah Shammah, Shalom, our peace. Jehovah Shammah, the Lord is there. Jehovah Tzidkenu, the Lord is our banner. You know, so I've revealed myself only to Moses as all the redemptive names. So if I look at a prophet like unto Moses, what is he trying to tell us? I stretch out my hands all day long by standing on a hill till the sun went down. And if you can realize that, you will say, his banner over us is love. Thank you for the cross. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Remember to join us tomorrow again at the same time for Word, Worship, and Wonders.